Well, welcome to Skinny Wednesday. The doctors told our guest that she was faking her illness, but she's going to show Christy.
Yeah, she has an amazing testimony, and what came out of that testimony is an amazing fitness program that we're going to be talking about.
Are you going to do a 30-minute workout in 8 minutes or 6 minutes?
Yeah, but you know I can handle it.
You can handle it. Okay. We've also going to tell you about the secret disease that nobody's. I didn't hear about it before in my life.
Yeah, yeah.
But you'll find out what's killing college athletes.
Absolutely. Plus, as Pat and I were talking about before, we are going to meet a fitness instructor who nearly died because doctors wouldn't treat her. But here's the deal. You're going to find out today how she survived and why she survived later on in today's 700
Club. That's exciting.
Yeah,
it's Skinny Wednesday. But first in the news, critics say the government is playing politics with a new measure to regulate Wall Street by bringing charges against Goldman Sachs just as debate heats up over a financial reform bill. Jennifer Wishon has that story.
To get any regulations passed, Democrats in the Senate need Republicans who have promised to filibuster the bill if they don't like it.
You either believe we need to strengthen oversight of Wall Street or you don't.
The massive legislation creates a new Consumer Protection Bureau to guard against lending abuses and brings new regulations to the largely unsupervised derivatives market. Banks are lobbying lawmakers hard, warning harsh regulations will only siphon money that's helping fuel the weak economy.
If you take money out of that system, then there's less of it, and you have a system that grinds to a halt.
Democrats have proposed including a $50 billion fund that Republicans fear will be used to prop up troubled banks in the future.
We need to end bailouts.
The president and Democrats are blaming the financial and economic meltdown on Wall Street, which did play a big role. But critics say others are also to blame, including Washington, which made a big push for home ownership. The mortgage industry, which loaned massive amounts of money to people who had no means to pay them back, and consumers who took on more debt than they could handle. But so far, megabank Goldman Sachs is the only institution being charged. The Securities and Exchange Commission has charged the company with fraud. But critics wonder if there was political motivation to bring these charges, just as the financial reform bill was coming up in Congress. Three Democratic commissioners voted to bring the charges, while two Republicans voted against them. And some analysts wonder if the charges will hold up. Economic expert Sebastian Mallaby writes in the Washington Post, unless the SEC is sitting on more evidence than it has laid out so far, the charge sheet looks flimsy. If Goldman has become a poster child for excessive power on Wall Street, the SEC might become a poster child for government power run amok. The SEC's 22-page complaint states that Goldman sold fancy mortgage securities without disclosing that a hedge fund manager, John Paulson, was betting that those same securities would go bad. This is a non-scandal. Politicians are now deciding what to do with money Goldman Sachs employees have donated to their campaigns. President Obama received nearly $1 million for his presidential bid. Senate Majority Leader Harry Reid attended a fundraiser with the company's president this year that raised nearly $40,000. Jennifer Wishon, CBN News, Washington.
Goldman Sachs. Let me ask you, did you ever hear about Alan Stanford?
No. Should I have?
Of course you should. Of course you should. That was an $8 billion Ponzi scheme run by a Texas financier who had an offshore bank, Stanford Financial, et cetera. The SEC missed him. They've brought a case against him that's hidden behind this Goldman Sachs. Big publicity about Goldman, nothing about Stanford. It was the same thing as Madoff. It was the same kind of Ponzi. And the thing about Goldman is they were dealing with a sophisticated German bank. And they're saying, well, the German bank was surprised that on a trade that there were two sides. One goes long, the other goes short. And they said, oh, isn't that shocking? Well, no, it's not shocking. Those German bankers are supposed to know better. But Stanford was taking little people's money, and just like Madoff was. But nothing. I mean, it was buried. Why? The SEC wanted to blow this thing up, get big publicity while they're hiding the fact that they screwed up on the Stanford investigation. So, anyhow, well, ladies and gentlemen, I think we've got to regulate this. But what they're not talking about is the fact that Fannie Mae and Freddie Mac have taken hundreds of billions of dollars And they were giving huge contributions to none other than...
Who?
Guess.
Who? Don't make me guess. Just tell me who.
Barack Obama, when he was a senator. That was just one of many. Harry Reid and others were cashing in. I dare say Chris Dodd was getting money. I don't know the list of all of them, but much money was coming out of the financial establishment toward Democratic senators. And for them to say, oh, it's horrible what they've done, it's just ridiculous. Well, Lee Webb has the rest of our top stories from the CBN newsroom.
Pat, out-of-control government debt is the greatest risk to global financial stability. That's the International Monetary Fund's latest warning. The IMF points to ballooning debt in Europe, the U.S., and Japan as the world's top threats. And it fears this global debt will kickstart a new financial decline. Banks in these countries could soon find it hard to lend money to businesses, which would in turn collapse the economy. The IMF wants the world's worst offenders, including the U.S., to lay out credible plans for reducing debt. The Oklahoma Senate has passed a bill requiring women seeking an abortion to have an ultrasound first. The bill also requires doctors to describe the fetus to the woman. The measure is one of five abortion-related bills passed Monday. The others would require women to complete a lengthy questionnaire before receiving an abortion and mandate certain signs be posted in abortion clinics. The ultrasound bill now heads to the governor's desk for consideration. Pat?
I'm all in favor of limiting abortion, but I do think the Supreme Court has struck down restrictions of this nature. So I don't know that the composition of the court is a great deal different than what it was. We've got 4-4 with a swing vote. I don't know if they would support this particular measure. It's pretty extreme and in today's world. So we'll have to see. But in the past, the Supreme Court has said, no, 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 you can't put that kind of a, quote, burden on women who want to get an abortion. I think they should put burdens, but nevertheless, I'm just talking about what the court says. And there's something else that the courts have said, and man, liberals are going fanatic. I mean, they're going bonkers on this one, Lee.
That's right, Pat. Liberals are criticizing Sarah Palin for her belief that America has a Christian history. Palin told a Christian women's conference, lest anyone try to convince you that God should be separated from the state, our founding fathers, they were believers. In Washington's farewell address, he wrote of all the dispositions and habits that lead to political prosperity, religion, faith, morality are indispensable supports. But a spokesman for the Secular Coalition of America tells ABC News, our Constitution established a secular government and has no mention of Jesus, Christianity, or a God of any kind. Call it a spiritual version of the Tea Party movement. One such rally was held in Lynchburg, Virginia this weekend. It was called Awakening 2010. And as Charlene Israel reports, the goal is to advance the shared values of faith and freedom.
To the top places of America.
Hundreds packed out Thomas Road Baptist Church on the campus of Liberty University to seek God for the next great spiritual awakening in America.
We're crying out tonight for God to just come and encounter us, for an awakening to break out. Like, this is the heart of God, like, to come to this, you know, this nation.
You can feel it. It's like there is a rumbling you can feel of a new generation emerging that says, you know, I want my nation back.
The two-day event was sponsored by the Freedom Federation, a faith-based group representing more than 30 million Americans who share common values and who oppose threats to their faith and freedom.
Faith and our freedom are important, and they're under attack. And that's why I think you're seeing this renewal, a reuniting of people, an awakening of people coming together.
Attendees here at Awakening 2010 may come from different backgrounds, different races, different walks of life, but they all have the same voice.
I have a hunger for change, for new beginnings, to seeing America wake up, the church come alive. And I stand strongly for the values, the moral values that our forefathers founded on this nation.
Me and my wife and I had actually considered saying, we're just going to leave America. We're not going to stay here anymore. If it's going to be like this, we're going to disengage. And I think we both decided that it's time to engage, not to disengage, time to awaken, not to fall asleep.
Christian leaders from across the country agree.
I'm convinced we're here to stand as a firewall of righteousness and justice against the spirit of cultural decay, moral apathy, moral relativism. So I do believe that this is a great season for America. We've never seen so much angst and trepidation, so much energy. The church is waking up in America. We're about to see a movement in America.
A movement many hope spreads across the country. Charlene Israel, CBN News.
Pat, back over to you.
Well, you know, Sarah Palin was right. The secularists have distorted the Constitution, distorted the meaning of our founding. The Declaration of Independence says it very clearly. We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are endowed by their Creator. It starts with the Creator. You know, when George Washington signed the Constitution, he signed it in the year of our Lord, 1787, I believe it was. In the year of our Lord. What Lord was he talking about? George III? In the year of our Lord. And it's clear that he was a Christian, and most of the other people in our foundation were Christian. The first act, I believe, of the new Congress was to appropriate money to have a chaplain and have prayer, and then they gave money to send Bibles to the Indians. This country was profoundly original. In 1892, Supreme Court ruled in the trustees' case. They said, quote, America is a Christian nation. That was in the Supreme Court ruling. I mean, you know, whatever you like it or not, that's what it says. And perhaps we're not a Christian nation now, but Obama comes in and says, we're not a Christian nation, we're a Hindu nation. No, we're not. Lee?
The military is having to turn away more recruits because of obesity. Ephraim Graham has this look at efforts to address what's being termed a national security threat.
A group of retired military officers says it's a wake-up call. More than a quarter of young adults are too fat to fight. Weight problems are now the number one medical reason why military recruits are rejected. A group called Mission Readiness says reversing the problem is a matter of national security, and it's calling on members of Congress to help.
Since 1995, the proportion of recruits rejected during their physical exams because they were overweight has increased by nearly 70%.
It's just one of the grim realities documented in this new report, Too Fat to Fight, by Mission Readiness. And although there isn't one fix, the group says schools are the best place to start. It wants Congress to do three things: get junk food out of schools, improve nutritional standards and the quality of school lunches, and provide more children and families access to programs that help them lose weight and eat better. The Senate Agriculture and Nutrition Committee has already passed legislation that achieves most of the group's goals, but the bill only funds half of the $10 billion it's requesting for changes.
Rigorous physical and mental standards are critical if we are to maintain the fighting readiness of our military.
This isn't the first time weight problems have been listed as a matter of national security. During World War II, military officers had the opposite problem. Too many recruits were malnourished. Congress acted then and is poised to act this time. Ephraim Graham, CBN News.
Well, I didn't know that about the World War II, Pat. I guess, you know, we were coming out of a depression. I wonder if that had something to do with it. But do you agree with this group's goals?
Well, I don't know about this group per se, but I do think that, I mean, you got a bunch of recruits, all right? So they belong to the Army now. They've signed up. Don't reject them and send them home. Send them to a rigorous camp. Put them on a restricted calorie diet of 1,500 calories or so a day and march them for hours on end. They'll lose weight in a hurry. And look, The Biggest Loser does it on NBC. I don't know why the Army can't do
That's
it.
That's true. I would be scared if you were my drill sergeant. Go around that mountain 100 more times.
That's right.
Get that belly off. Well, you know, I think the byproduct, I think, is just the weight. But I think the true issue that society is dealing with is just lack of discipline. You know, we have lack of discipline in terms of what we eat, in terms of sometimes our work, our spiritual life, so many different elements of it that we just have to get back into
discipline.
The Army controls them. Once they are in the Army,
yeah,
they've been recruited, they've been drafted, they've been volunteers or whatever. The Army now says, here's where you live, here's where you eat, and here's your regimen. They can set up a program of weight loss. Those guys would peel weight off like there was no tomorrow if they put them through a 30 to 45, 60-day program. They say if NBC can do it, surely the U.S. Army can do it. Lee?
Two new studies say Americans are eating too much salt and sugar, and it's causing a rise in blood pressure and cholesterol. The problem is not just from people sprinkling salt and sugar on food, it's in processed foods and like burgers and sodas. A leading medical group wants the government to set mandatory levels for salt in foods, but the Food and Drug Administration plans to work with the industry to help Americans gradually cut back without new regulations.
We all recognize that sodium in the American diet is a very serious problem and that we as a nation need to aggressively address this.
Americans eat more than twice the amount of salt dietitians recommend. Pat?
Did you ever see a bottle of barbecue sauce?
Sure.
Did you read the label of what was on it?
Well, actually, you know what? That's funny. I actually have recently, and there's so much stuff in it.
That's right. What did you see about sodium?
That it's extraordinarily high, as well as the sugar and high fructose and so many other variables.
Just a couple of
ingredients.
A couple of squirts of barbecue sauce. I mean, a couple of tablespoons, and you've got 830 milligrams of salt just for starters. Not to mention the sugar. You're exactly right. It's everywhere.
Yeah.
All the canned vegetables, almost without exception, have salt. And then we were showing about soup, about MSG, some of the things we put in them. But ladies and gentlemen, you got to read the labels. 2,300 milligrams of salt is supposed to be, for a normal person, that's the rule. Somebody over 50, it's less than that, maybe 1,500 milligrams. And, you know, you just can't be adding salt. What I'm using these days is sea salt, which doesn't have as much sodium. You like that?
I do the same thing, and you can use less of it, and it's a coarser salt. But the key is just cook it yourself. Don't buy it in a package. Don't buy it in a box. You know, just get your vegetables, get your meats, and cook it yourself. Then you have the control over what you put in your food.
Frozen stuff is pretty good for that. But anyhow, we've got something else we're
going to
talk
This
about.
Is a really, really interesting story coming up. It's the silent killer. And check this out, no one is actually immune to it.
We've seen it in males, we've seen it in females, we've seen it in football, we've seen it in other sports.
Get the warning signs for this disease when we come back.
This is for legs. Legs that take a stand. Curves works for your legs. Try Curves and get 30 days for just $30. This is for arms. Arms that are too important to hide. Curves works for your arms. Now get 30 days for just $30. This is for healthy, happy hearts. Curves works for your heart and every other part of you. Our 30-minute circuit works every major muscle group, two muscles at a time. So you get a total body workout that can burn up to 500 calories. All with a trainer to teach and motivate. Call Curves today to get 30 days on our proven circuit for just $30. And join us in improving the lives of women everywhere. Curves. Let's all be stronger together.
Tomorrow.
You're not the first woman that's ever had this happen to you.
How one group helps single moms survive and thrive.
When I came here, I was broken, but I feel able to go on.
Plus, one songwriter quits the hottest rap group in the country.
I wasn't proud when my songs were played in front of my mother or my nephew.
Tomorrow on the 700 Club.
Did you ever hear of sickle cell anemia?
Absolutely. In fact, it's one of the killers that tends to target African-Americans.
African-Americans, sickle cell. Well, there's something else that seems to be related. We're not quite sure, and I've never heard of it before, but today you're going to hear about it. Last week, the NCAA voted to require all athletes, all of them, black and white, male and female, to be tested for sickle cell, not anemia, but sickle cell trait. It's different from sickle cell anemia. Many people never even knew they have it. But as Laurie Johnson tells us, when you combine it with rigorous exercise, death.
Wow.
Here's
Bridget Lloyd remembers her son Dale as a strong Christian athlete with a brilliant future. But without warning, his life was taken away by a hidden killer.
When you lose a child, you lose a part of yourself. You lose a part of your heart. Your spirit is gone. And I think you have to realize that there's only one way to make it out. There's only one way, the grace of God, to give you strength each and every day to get up, to see another day, to try to not let this happen to another young person's life.
Dale, a Rice University football player, collapsed during a strenuous practice. The cause of death? Complications from sickle cell trait. Unlike people with sickle cell anemia who have two abnormal hemoglobin genes that produce mostly dangerous sickle-shaped blood cells, people with the trait have only one abnormal hemoglobin gene and their blood cells are mostly a healthy round shape. But when people with the trait intensely exercise, their round blood cells can take on that sickle shape, become sticky, and clog blood vessels. The fix is resting, which returns the cells to their round shape. Complications from sickle cell trait is the number one cause of death for college football players. It's been linked to 10 on-field deaths in the last decade. But they didn't happen during games. Instead, they occurred during rigorous training. Like most players carrying the trait, Dale didn't know he had it. His family sued Rice University and the NCAA. As a result, the NCAA will require all Division I schools to test athletes for the trait. Currently, only 64% of colleges screen for it voluntarily.
I think it's so important that we understand that this is about saving these young people's lives.
Beginning August 1st, all athletes will either take a blood test, provide proof that they already had the test, or opt out of the test by signing a waiver releasing their school from liability.
In the competitive world of sports, many wonder if having the sickle cell trait hurts an athlete's chance for success.
Curtis Lofton has it, and it hasn't slowed him down. As starting middle linebacker for the Atlanta Falcons, he had 160 tackles last year. At age 23, he's on his way to becoming one of the best players in the league. He says listening to his body is a matter of life or death.
My back starts cramping up, or I start becoming short of breath, and just things like that. And that's when I kind of got a feeling like, hey, Curtis, you need to chill out. You need to pull back some.
And so you rest for what, a few minutes?
For me, it's probably about 30 seconds. I mean, it's just a little 30 seconds to a minute because you know, I don't have the trait, so I really don't have full-on sickle cell. And that's a big difference between the trait and the sickle cell.
His faith in Christ helps him deal with his condition.
He's the one that wakes me up in the morning, and I pray a lot. And sometimes when I run these sprints, you know, I have to stop and I just say a little prayer that helped me keep going or help me finish what I need to do.
Lofton first learned of his condition after being tested when he played for the University of Oklahoma Sooners. His trainer there became a driving force behind nationwide sickle cell trait testing after one of his players nearly died and no one knew why.
The ignorance that we held was held by physicians, athletic trainers, coaches, athletes, really everyone in sports.
Anderson says since 1990, only two of his 20 players who tested positive knew they had it.
Hospitals in every state screen newborns for sickle cell trait, but many parents don't know the results of those screenings or forget them when their baby grows up.
One in 12 African Americans carries the trait, but people with Spanish, Greek, Italian, Asiatic Indian, and Mediterranean ancestry are also affected.
We've seen it in males, we've seen it in females, we've seen it in football, we've seen it in other sports.
So while some players never survived sickle cell trait complications, their deaths raised awareness that may prevent others from suffering the same fate. Lori Johnson, CBN News.
And Chrissy, I want you to promise me something.
Yeah.
That you won't exercise so hard that you'll build up those traits.
I won't, and that's a promise. I promise. You know, the one thing that I took from that story, Pat, was just really, we just need to listen to our bodies.
That's right.
And that, you know, sometimes we feel like press through, and sometimes it's like it's okay to chill out.
All right, you're going to promise to do that?
I promise to do that.
Okay.
Yeah. I need to be around to harass you.
All right, please. There's a long future for that.
Absolutely. Well, coming up, one fitness instructor's brush with death. What the doctors found after they gave her a clean bill of health.
3 years ago, we got a call. My mother broke her hip getting in her tub. She had been lying there for 2 hours before a neighbor happened to hear her.
I don't think about that day. I think about the day I got my premier bath. It's made my life so much better.
If you or someone you love has a mobility issue that could lead to a slip in the tub or shower, you owe it to yourself to call Premier Bathrooms, the world-class leader in transforming your bathroom with safe, easy-to-use, easy-entry baths featuring hydrotherapy.
It's a beautiful transformation for your bathroom and for your life.
Call right now to get your free information. It's that easy. Let Premier Bathroom share over 20 years of trusted expertise and guaranteed results.
Call 888-228-7067.
You and I are ordinary people. Ordinary people who are capable of affecting the world in extraordinary ways. Come to Regent University. When you earn your degree from Regent, you become a vital part of the mission we all share. Christian leadership to change the world. For a free welcome kit, visit lead.regent.edu or call 866-REGENT-U.
What is your body telling you right now? Are you tired? Are you exhausted? Are you pumped up? Well, for Teresa Rowe, her body was telling her she had a serious problem, even though the doctor says she would fine. But Teresa kept listening to her own body, and what she heard actually saved her life.
Teresa Rowe says life is about wholeness, wellness, and knowing your body, not just trying to get into a pair of skinny jeans. Well, Teresa was a fitness instructor, but she wasn't always the picture of health. One day, she was exhausted and went to the emergency room. Even though Teresa was sent home, she knew something was wrong. Later, Teresa collapsed. Then the doctors discovered a hole in her heart that required open heart surgery. On the long road to recovery, Teresa learned secrets of developing a strong core, physically and spiritually. And shaped by faith, Teresa shares what she learned and why it takes more than exercise to find true fitness.
Really good one, too. Please welcome to the 700 Club the author of Shaped by Faith, 10 Secrets to Strengthening Your Body and Soul. Teresa, thank you so much for being here today.
Thank you for having me.
You have an amazing testimony, an amazing. So let's talk a little bit about it. You know, there, as a fitness instructor, you were in shape, you were feeling phenomenal, but then you started to feel fatigued and had some challenges. And what happened?
Right. My body was telling me there was something wrong, yeah. And I believe God had his hand on me the whole time.
Yeah.
The doctors told me maybe I had PMS. I was a single mother at the time. And finally, they listened to me. They did an echocardiogram and found the hole. And I had open heart surgery from there. 20 years later, I'm out running with my running partner, Jackie. And I'm not feeling good. I'm dizzy. I'm fatigued. But I go in. We do about 5 miles, go in, teach my class, and just something wasn't right. My friend Susie is telling me, your coloring doesn't look right.
Yeah.
So I went into the doctor. They said, you're fine.
Yeah.
And went to another cardiologist, and he said, at any moment, you know, you could go. You could go into cardiac arrest because the patch that they placed on my heart had come loose. So my heart rate was like 38 beats a minute. I didn't feel my heart rate. I could run and not feel it.
Wow.
Exercise. So actually, they had to rush me to Vanderbilt University, and they had to find a cardiac pediatrician to do the surgery that specialized in the hole where it was. So I'm all fixed. God's got his hand on me. Praise God.
Come
praise
on.
Jesus.
Yes. Thank
well,
you, Lord.
Well,
let's talk about the Lord and then in the role that the Lord
yes.
played in helping you listen to your body. Because it's not
yes.
just, yeah, it's how you feel, but it's also, Lord, you know, the Holy Spirit speaks to us.
The Holy
and
Spirit
the Lord,
speaks
Holy Spirit
to
spoke
us.
To you. What happened?
Yes. Well, the Holy Spirit just let me know to check my heart.
Mm.
I kept
hearing. This was after the first surgery.
Yes.
Now we're, yeah.
Yes, just check your heart, check your heart. And I thought it meant check my spiritual heart.
I know, right?
I'm like, okay, I'm trusting the Lord with all your heart. Lean not on your own understanding. I'm going to that scripture.
Yeah.
I'm reading all the scriptures on the heart. I'm like, Lord, change me. Take out anything that's yucky that's in there. And I didn't realize it was a physical heart.
Yeah.
You know, I was just a little dizzy, a little fatigued. I could still teach my fitness classes. Mm-hmm. But he let me know also in my spirit, there's something wrong. Listen to that. And so that's why I went to the first cardiologist.
Amazing. Well, you take that whole mindset of just listening to your body, listening to the Holy Spirit,
yes,
reading the Word of God, and you incorporate all those different facets into a workout plan, which we're going to do right now.
Yes, I'm excited.
Yeah.
You?
Girl, I'm all about it. I'm all about
okay.
it. All right,
okay.
So work me out. Tell us
all
what
right.
we're going to do.
We're going to do Pilates.
Okay.
It's exercises that strengthen the core,
okay,
all through the abdominals and the spine, and it strengthens your hips and your glutes, and it helps you to be flexible, and it brings body awareness.
Okay.
Body awareness. So I always tell people, scoop in your belly,
mm-hmm,
below your belly button where your transverse abdominals are, deepest,
yeah,
abdominal muscles,
mm-hmm,
pull everything in and up. First thing, you hit the floor in the morning, praise Jesus for this,
mm-hmm,
day. This is your day, Lord. Scoop it in.
Okay, let's
all
start.
Right?
Let's start.
Okay.
So as we sit on the ball,
we're going to sit up tall.
Yes.
Scoop your belly in.
Mm-hmm.
Go ahead and extend the arms up over your head. Inhale through your nose. Exhaling, bringing those arms, reach them out as far as you can. Bring the arms back up about shoulder height. Let's rotate to the right side. Exhaling out of your mouth.
Teresa, what's the difference between
inhaling
Pilates and
nose?
Yoga?
Pilates is all about movement. It's all about core strength. It's
okay.
all about strengthening the body from head to toe. Strengthening that body from head to toe. Yoga is wonderful as well, but Pilates, I love to move in Pilates. Go ahead and lie down on your floor.
Okay.
So we're going to drape the legs over the ball.
Oops.
I want you to squeeze the ball towards you. Keep
okay.
the belly in. Extend your arms. Take an inhale through the nose. We're finding our neutral spine. Exhaling, pulling that belly really pressed down. Let's do that again. Inhale through the nose. Exhaling out of your mouth. Place your feet on the ball. Now, strengthen the legs. So squeeze the leg muscles. Exhale, extend them out away from you. Keep that belly in. Bring it back in. Inhale. Exhaling, you want the exercise to flow, so the breathing is most important as you
gotcha.
Keep in everything. Exhale and inhale. Let's drape the legs over the ball. Again, squeeze. This is called the 100.
Mm-hmm.
Lift your arms about 6 inches off your mat. We're going to pump them down using our triceps towards the mat. Hold. Walk the ball away from your body. Go ahead and flex up. Look towards your belly and pump those arms. Inhale, 2, 3, 4, 5.
Now, Teresa, this really works the core.
It's warming up the core. It's warming up the spine.
Now, what's the significance of the core as we do this?
The core is all about stability, and spine, and movement, and strength. If the core is strong, everything in the body is strong.
Gotcha.
Lower the ball down.
Isn't that just like in spiritual life, right?
Yes.
Come on, girl.
Hands on the outside of the ankle, inside of the knee. Now just move the legs one at a time. Keep the belly in. Bring
now,
the feet
on the ball. Now, when you do this, and you do this at home, you also pray.
Oh, my gosh. This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Thank
yes.
you, Lord Jesus, for my strong, healthy body.
Yes.
Bring the ball in.
What's the importance
arms
of scripture?
Out.
You know, people always say, okay, Skinny Wednesday, it just focuses on the physical. But
oh,
it's not just the physical.
No.
What does the Bible talk about?
It's all about, you know, worshiping the Lord by taking care of our temples that He has given us.
Yeah.
He has given us these temples. Go ahead and hold the ball. So we're going to use this time with Him, okay, to worship Him, to praise Him. This is a great one, Christy.
Okay.
Inhale, roll up through your spine, articulating your spine, each vertebrae at a time. Extend way over the legs. Inhale, slowly rolling down. We're using every single abdominal muscle in the body. We're using the arms. Inhale to slowly peel the spine off the mat. Exhaling over your legs. Inhale, we're going to do that one time. This time we're going to stay seated up, okay?
Okay, and these are great stretches,
inhale,
too, for your back
up.
And your hamstrings.
Yes, it lengthens your spine.
Absolutely.
Lengthens your muscles. Place the ball down. Flex your feet. Sit up tall. Pull it in.
Okay.
Roll the ball away from your body.
Oh.
Bring it back in.
I
transitioning.
Good.
I did, too.
Oh.
Bring the ball back.
You get up so much gracefully. More gracefully than I did today.
Drape yourself
all right.
over the ball. We're going to do some push-ups.
Okay.
Walk your body out. Keep the belly in. Inhale, lower. Exhale, push-up. Inhale.
All right, here we go.
I've got my hair sticking to my lipstick. I
normally
don't wear makeup to work out. Walk the ball.
It's all good.
Back.
Woo.
Let's sit up on the ball.
Okay, praise God.
Yes.
I'm trying to do this as dainty and as ladylike as possible. I don't know.
We're gonna roll down.
Okay.
Cross the arms.
Now, what are we working on now?
We're working all core and spine.
The core again.
Trust in the Lord with all your heart. Lean not on your own understanding as you crunch. In all your ways, follow him, and he will direct your path.
Come on, girl.
And strengthen your core. Yes.
Yes.
Hands on the ball. Walk back. Praise Jesus. Thank you.
Amen.
Woo!
High five, girl. That was lovely. We had our spiritual time, our physical time. We had the whole nine yards, and let me get the book. Okay.
Oh,
I'm sore, but not from doing this. Okay. That was
the
wonderful. For more of Teresa Rose exercises, all you have to do is check out her DVD. Here it is. And it's called Shaped by Faith Pilates. Or you can always pick up a copy of her book. It's called Shaped by Faith, 10 Secrets to Strengthening Your Body and Your Soul. And it's available nationwide. That was lovely.
Thank you.
Thank you so much for being here, girl.
Thank you.
God bless you.
Bless you.
All right, Pat. Over to you.
All right, Christy. Are you sore or not?
Well, I was sore because I worked out this morning, so this actually made me feel better. Oh,
okay. Well, don't start singing. That's cool. All right. Well, still ahead, we're going to bring it on with your Skinny Wednesday email. Mitch says, my sister says we shouldn't drink water with our meals because it dilutes the digestive juices. Is this true? We'll tackle that question and more later on today's 700 Club.
What makes the miracles of Jesus even more miraculous? Standing where they happened, in Israel. Come visit Capernaum, where Jesus restored a paralytic's helpless legs. Sail the Sea of Galilee, where Jesus walked on the water. Stroll through the Garden of Gethsemane, where Jesus healed a servant's ear. To learn more about standing where it all happened, in Israel, visit www.goisrael.com. Come visit Israel.
Cookie from the cookie jar.
You?
Yes, me, and I lost 105 pounds.
I stole the cookies from the cookie jar. Yes, me, and I lost 115 pounds in 6 months.
If you want to lose up to 15 pounds a month, get Smart for Life cookies. Doctors develop Smart for Life cookies with extracts from natural ingredients like fruits, vegetables, wheat, and dairy. Smart cookie meals replace breakfast and lunch so you can save $1,200 a year on food.
Just pop a cookie. It'll save you a fortune over other plans. Eat cookies, lose weight. It's that simple.
Order now and get a free week of cookies plus free UPS delivery. Lose weight, save money. An average of $1,200 a year on food. Get smart. Call 1-800-209-0368. That's 1-800-209-0368.
Welcome back to the 700 Club. A judge in Arizona says churches have a First Amendment right to ring bells. Neighbors had complained that the bells at Christ the King Church in Phoenix were played too loud and too often. The city had ordered the church to stop playing them. The church and two other congregations sued, calling the noise ordinance unconstitutional.
It brings the law really into line with almost all the other cities and jurisdictions we've looked at where you can't use a noise ordinance to suppress religious expression.
The judge also ordered the city to pay the churches $25,000 in attorney fees and court costs. Some lawmakers believe the Obama administration may be covering up information about the Fort Hood shooting. A Senate committee has issued subpoenas for details regarding the attack that left 13 people dead. And whether it could have been prevented. The Justice Department says releasing that information could compromise the prosecution of accused gunman Major Nadal Hassan. Lawmakers want to know why Hassan was promoted despite his suspected ties to terrorists. You can always get the latest from CBN News by going to our website at cbn.com. Pat and Christy will be back with more of the 700 Club after this.
During the spring each year, the entire staff of CBN sets aside a special week of prayer. Each day we pray for you and your family. We care about you and the things that you need in your life right now. Whether they're large or small, we want to pray with you. We believe in a God who answers prayer, and we want to see the Lord accomplish miracles in your life. Please mail your prayer request today. It's our privilege to pray for you.
I've often asked the question, is investing in gold right for me? In fact, many people think that owning gold is only for the wealthy. But you can own gold with a minimal investment. It's easy to own gold. At Goldline, our clients invest in physical gold, not gold stocks or gold funds. Call Goldline and talk with an account executive who can answer your questions and discuss the available gold products, like our popular European coins or proof American coins. Your gold is then shipped directly to you, or we will arrange storage for you. Goldline has been helping investors acquire precious metals since 1960, and we work with new clients every day who have decided that it's time to invest in gold. Isn't it time that you consider gold? I invite you to join the thousands of hardworking, satisfied clients who have chosen Goldline to help diversify by investing in gold. Call Goldline now and receive a free investor's kit and the American Advisor newsletter. Our account executives are here 6 days a week to serve you. Give us a call today.
Tomorrow.
You're not the first woman that's ever had this happen to you.
How one group helps single moms survive and thrive.
When I came here, I was broken, but I feel able to go on.
Plus, one songwriter quits the hottest rap group in the country.
I wasn't proud when my songs were played in front of my mother or my nephew.
Tomorrow on the 700 Club.
Well, we're back, and it's time to bring it on with your email questions. We're going to jump right in with Mitch, who writes in for Pat and says, Pat, we need you to settle an ongoing family argument. My sister says that we shouldn't drink water with our meals because it dilutes the digestive juices. I like to have a glass of water when I eat. Does drinking water interfere with digestion?
Mitch, as a matter of fact, doctors say that a glass of water with food is a good thing. Actually, your digestion doesn't take place till it gets down into your intestines, and by then, the amount of dilution is almost minimal. You know, it's 1 to 2,000 parts or something. So, absolutely, drink. I mean, don't overdo it, but a glass of water is not going to hurt you at all. It's not going to interfere with your digestive juices. So, your sister or whoever's telling you that is wrong.
I'm sure he wanted to say strong. Right. Drinking water is the best thing for you, especially if you're trying to lose weight. You drink a glass of water before you start eating.
Yeah.
Why do processed foods contain so much salt? Is it something our taste buds want, or are there just some practical reasons as well?
Well, I think it's they think it's tasty, especially with soup and stuff like that. We talked about MSG and what they do to. Listen, they're trying to sell stuff to you. And they want to make it as tasty as possible. Now, there is a group of food called salt snacks. They're sold by beer companies, you know, like Pretzels and things like that, loaded with salt. And the reason is they want to create a thirst so you'll drink their beer. And that's why they do that. But in terms of canned food, well, you know, salt has been used as a preservative. It apparently takes the moisture out of some kinds of food, and you know, you salt meat and things like that, it preserves it. In terms of the vegetables, they've got all kinds of juice in them anyhow, so the salt, it really is irrelevant in terms of preservative. It's just something to make it flavorful and make you want to eat them. That's why they put a lot of salt on them.
That's true. You said it.
Read the labels.
Mm-hmm. Destiny writes in, and Destiny says, I know you used to be a runner, Pat, and had some trouble with your knee. Some people think that running barefoot is easier on their body because it makes you your heel strike differently. What do you think?
Well, they taught us when I was doing my little running thing that you came down with your heel first and then rotated forward. But they say it's like a pile driver that comes in hard every time, and you hit that 7,000 or 8,000 times in a run that you're jamming stuff up all the way up your leg. And with me, I had both knees scoped, finally had to have a partial knee replacement, so I'm not a fan of running,
running on
a thing. But, I mean, my goodness, if you run, if, you know, the human beings, your bottom of your foot can get hard and calloused, so it's like a shoe. You know, the people overseas in Africa and so forth, they walk barefoot all the time, no problem. But initially, you step out, and every step is an anguish. You hit a pebble, and it hurts. So be careful. But the idea is that you, when you're barefoot, you'll come down on your toes, you'll spring, and it's not quite as jarring on your body, but you got to have something on your feet or else you're going to kill yourself.
Mm-hmm. That's the truth. I remember watching one marathon once, and the front runners were these guys from Kenya. They were barefoot, and those jokers ran. They beat us all.
it's just like leather. I mean, mm-hmm. they don't feel anything because this is so hard from use of.
Exactly.
But, you know, they use the term tenderfoot, but you don't want to get out there and cut your feet all to pieces.
All exactly. Right. All right. Matt writes in, and Matt says, one of the guys at the gym was saying that everyone should start drinking alkaline water. What exactly is alkaline water, and what are the benefits?
Well, you've either got acidic or you've got alkaline in your body, and if you eat a lot of meat and things like that, you'll get uric acid, which will make your body want to suck the calcium out of your bones. Whereas if your system is alkaline, your bones stay intact. So it's better to eat fruits and vegetables. Lay off of meat where possible and fatty food, and that's get a balance. But the so-called pH balance, I don't know, people that go around taking their blood and all this, that's not what I want to do. But nevertheless, that's what alkaline water is all about. And they think it might help them in terms of athletic performance. I don't know that it does, but that's what they claim.
Interesting.
All right.
I want to cut down on the fat in my diet. Is it better to focus on fat grams or total calories from fat?
I think fat grams is the way you measure it because you're not sure about the calorie count. But I think you ought to figure so many grams. And if you figure the grams, you multiply the grams times whatever they eat or whatever for fat, and you've got the number of calories. So if you have the grams, you've got the calories. When I had a diet program that I put out, I measured grams of protein, grams of carbs, grams of fat, and had it balanced. You want a little bit of everything. You don't want to cut out fat. Fat is not necessarily a bad thing, especially if it's vegetable fat and things like olive oil and things like that. They're very good for you. Fish oil is a fat, but it's good for you. The thing that clogs your arteries is saturated fat, animal fat, butter, cream, that kind of thing.
Mm-hmm. I was going to piggyback, and you just took my answer.
I'm so glad.
You took it.
That's what I'm supposed to do. They want me to answer the questions.
Okay. Well, and avocados are a good fat, too.
Oh,
you know I always have to add in my little tidbit.
You got the last word. Avocados. All right, whatever.
Phyllis writes in and says, I know that red wine is supposed to be healthy for my heart, but I'm on a medication that prevents me from consuming alcohol. Is it possible to get the same benefits from drinking grape juice instead?
Would you like a long answer? The best thing for resveratrol, which key, you know, it, you got these telomeres in your chromosomes, mm-hmm. and they get chopped off year after year after year after year.
Yeah.
And after a while, they get so small, then you get all wrinkled and old and you die.
Good
so
thought.
If you have resveratrol, it preserves the telomeres and keeps them from getting chopped off. Mm-hmm. Now, what's the best way of doing that? It's to get a grape that has been attacked by some type of a fungus or a disease, and it has overcome the disease. And you take the grapes from that, and it gives you the resistance to resist disease, okay?
Yeah, but you're not making that very enticing. You're talking about grapes being all disease-ridden.
Well, that's the game. Do you want long telomeres or short telomeres?
Let's just drink red wine and call it a day.
But she can't do it because of medicine. Red grape juice is cool, but I would, and grapes are cool. But the thing that they have got is muscatine grapes that went through this process. They overcame the disease. They've got a resistance built up within them. You take that. Now, I think one of the companies has something called Vivex or Vivex. You've seen it?
No.
It's you take about a tablespoon a day or mm-hmm. a teaspoon. It has resveratrol.
Okay.
It's cool.
Good to know.
And it came from these muscatine grapes that had been assaulted mm-hmm. by these funguses.
Can I just say this, Pat? If I'm ever on the game show, Who Wants to Be a Millionaire, will you be my call a friend?
What is...
I need to call a friend because I don't know about the resveratrol. I don't know about the grapes.
Well, the resveratrol is what you're looking for, but wine has it, but not that much. I mean, it's good, but a red grape juice is just as good, or purple grape juice, probably as good as wine.
Well, we can talk about this for
you
the next half hour.
Well,
all right. Up, I gotta switch gears.
All right.
Drunkenness is not good.
Not good.
Not good. Up next, a freak accident breaks the back of a gymnastics coach.
Some days were worse than others. I used crutches and canes, and I kept going. I did shows even though I had the disability.
Watch how 20 years of back pain vanished in an instant right after this.
Hi, I'm Terry Musin. I'd like to tell you about Orphans Promise. Orphans Promise helps children who've had tragic beginnings in life.
My father died, my mother started drinking, and gave me away to the orphanage. We were homeless, and she made me beg for food.
We don't know where our sister is. I'm looking for her now.
We want to return to be with our mother, but she doesn't want us.
In many countries, children are turned out of orphanages when they turn 16. They lose the only security they've ever known. Many will become easy prey for prostitution rings and criminal gangs. Together, you and I can break this cycle for these kids. For just $20 a month, you'll provide computer training, life skills, and people that care, preparing them for a future of hope. Show them God's love. Call the number on your screen right now and say you'll help.
If you love fresh garden tomatoes but hate digging, bending, and weeding, then get off the ground and grow your tomatoes upside down with the Topsy Turvy Tomato Planter. Only the original Topsy Turvy has our patented grow bag technology. The sun warms the planter like a greenhouse, so the root system explodes, giving you up to 30 pounds of delicious garden tomatoes with no digging or weeding. Perfect for small yards, patios, even your porch. So grow your tomatoes the easy way and get your Topsy Turvy today.
Having a bad back is bad news for anyone, and more so for a champion gymnastics coach. Well, for 20 years, Dejanine King suffered through the aches and the pains, but then one day she watched the 700 Club.
You know, everyone walks around saying they have a bad back, but I seriously had a very bad back. I needed a new spine. I needed a miracle.
That's because Dejanine King had a terrible accident. She was heading into a business office when a part of an outdoor sign fell 30 feet and crushed her spine. Walking toward the building was the last thing she remembered.
Before I knew it, it was 28 days later. I woke up from my coma and found out I was in an accident. I was told by doctors that the type of injury I had, I'd be, you know, disabled, unable to walk, talk, or use manual dexterity skills.
She had sciatica, which is an interference with the nerves of the low back. Being pinched, she had pain in her low back going down to her calves and sometimes to her feet.
The damage pretty much meant the end of her career as an award-winning gymnastics coach. She did physical therapy for 8 months. When she was dismissed from the hospital, she could walk and talk, but there was still nerve damage in her spine. She could barely do normal activities like household chores. She lived in pain for 20 years. Life was hard, but she was determined to readjust to her normal activities.
Some days were worse than others. I used crutches and canes, and I kept going. I did shows even though I had the disability.
Over the years, Dejanine had become a faithful viewer of the 700 Club. One day as she watched,
at the end of the show, Pat Robertson described somebody with a very unique situation with their back. It was me.
There's a nerve block in somebody's spinal cord, and it may be causing a type of paralysis. God, just relieve that nerve block, and you will feel sensation in your lower extremities. God has just healed you right now in Jesus' name.
Dejanine knew she was healed. She hasn't had any back pain since that day, and her doctor can attest to the changes in her back.
She came back in, and there was no pain in her back. But more importantly, there was no more muscle spasms, no more swelling, and her alignment was perfect.
Dejanine can teach and even participate in her gymnastic classes again. She says she's thankful to God for her healing.
People should know this about God. He's in the healing business. It's his timing. That's the part us humans don't understand too well. But I waited 20 years. I'm going to make up for the lost time.
Let's believe that today is the day that your miracle is going to happen. You know, the Bible says that when two or more touch anything, agree on anything, it's going to be done. So we know that today is the day, and we pray that today is the day that your answer to prayer will happen.
All right.
Yeah, let's encourage you.
Yes,
You know what, Pat? Let's see here. Kinslow from Florida, she heard Pat give a word of knowledge about a throat problem. She placed her hand on her throat and instantly the pain went away. I have another one I want to encourage you. George from Maryland heard a word of knowledge on the program about cataracts being healed. Pat, he claimed the word. Guess what? God healed his eyes.
The cataracts?
Cataracts. Cataracts.
Well, this is Marcia. She lives in Hillsboro, Illinois. Marcia was struggling with pneumonia. And one night, she was watching our program, and Christy, you had a word of knowledge about somebody having trouble breathing and a lung condition. Marcia said, "That's me." She claimed that word, and from that moment on, she's not having any breathing problem whatsoever. Marcia in Hillsboro, Illinois. Ladies and gentlemen, time to pray. And you say, "Well, those were special people." No, they weren't special. I mean, they're doctors, lawyers, Indian chiefs, they're accountants, and they're bookkeepers, and they're housewives, and they're students, and they're people just like you and me. We're just people, and God loves us all. So, yes, we're special in his eyes, but there's no one more special than anybody else. We're all special. So you're special, and God has a word for you. He has a message for you, and if you have a sickness or an injury, let's believe God. Let's believe God for you right now. Now, Christy and I are going to join hands together, and we're going to trust God for you right now. Father,
thank you.
In Jesus' name, we give you praise and worship. You are God Almighty. We acknowledge you in front of all the people that with you all things are possible and nothing is impossible. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, we speak the word of faith, and may the power of God touch you. There's a bile duct that has been blocked, and you're having kidney problems. You're having, I don't know whether it's jaundice or whatever it is, but God is healing you of that. That bile duct is opening in the name of Jesus.
There's an abnormality in someone's pituitary gland, and I don't really understand it, but the Lord is 100% healing you right now. Those doctor's reports, all the doctor's theories, they're going to come in a line with the word of God and the promise that he's given you. You are fine in the name of Jesus. The Lord is also healing someone with a deviated septum. Jesus. Thank you, Jesus.
Abscess, a really bad abscess. It may involve a couple of teeth, but if you'll put your hand on that part of your jaw where it hurts and just believe God right now, that abscess is going to break and drain and you're going to be completely healed in the name of Jesus.
I don't know if this is one of the same, but the Lord is also healing someone with a urinary tract infection, another one with a bladder infection right now in the name of Jesus.
A throat is being healed. Just touch your throat in Jesus' name. You'll be able to swallow and you will be whole in Jesus' name. Now may the power of God touch you from this moment on. Praise you, Lord. Amen.
Amen.
If you need further prayer, please call, and also call and tell us what God's done for you. We love to hear testimonies of what God has done. It's toll free, 1-800-759-0700. These words from Psalm 103, "Praise the Lord and forget not all his benefits, who forgives all your sins and heals all your diseases." See you tomorrow. Bye-bye.
Amen. Good show.
Hi, I'm Terry Newsom. I've had the privilege of traveling all around the world and seeing firsthand the difference you're making through your partnership.
In Turkey, CBN partners are caring for orphans and teaching them computer skills so they can find good jobs when they become adults. In Haiti, you are there bringing much-needed medicine, clean water, and food to help the Haitian people through this disaster. All around the world, you bring the hope of Jesus Christ to people who have nowhere to turn. Just like you did for Dilcia, this little girl's cough turned into pneumonia, but her parents couldn't afford medicine. That's when you brought a medical clinic to their village and gave Dilcia the treatment that saved her life. Your monthly gift makes it possible to care for victims of disaster, feed the hungry, preach the gospel, and so much more. Please watch for this mailing and send in your pledge.
Imagine giving someone hope for a better future. You do that every day, and it only happens because you were there.